Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for having me here. I am really, really pleased to be here, but more importantly, I'm very, very lucky to be here. To cut a long story short, on Tuesday night, I landed up at Melbourne Airport, ready to board my flight to Singapore, only to find out that my passport validity had 3 days, only 3 days under the 6 month period. I wasn't allowed to board the flight. Gutted, shattered, I rang John Nixon and Tony Hansen and asked for some options. Guess what the options were? Tony's options was either using hologram or a video of myself being beamed here from Melbourne. Or the third option was, he said, go and get yourself an emergency passport. So I went for the third option. And 2 o'clock that night, 2 o'clock that night to about 3 o'clock in the morning, I was on Google Analytics trying to work out, I kid you not, trying to work out the most optimal route to get to a passport photograph outlet and make my 7 o'clock in the morning coffee round and then get to the passport office to plead at 8 o'clock in the morning to get an emergency passport. And thanks to big data in Google, I was able to do that. It gave me the tram route, it told me where to hail a cab, it told me where to alight, it told me how to walk from the passport photograph outlet to the passport office, all in time to get a passport delivered by 11 o'clock in the morning to board the afternoon flight. And all that was because of big data that allowed me to find out the most effective way to get the optimal solution I wanted that morning. Infrastructure genetics, ladies and gentlemen, is no different to just what I did with Google, which was joining the dots. And infrastructure genetics is really the science of applying patterns, of applying behavior trends by understanding how infrastructure performs, just like we human performs, and to look at this concept of genetics to kind of realign those patterns and reinvent new ways of doing things. It's different to the traditional understand the past and predict the future. Infrastructure genetics is like human genetics. Not all athletes are going to be the same. Not all musicians are going to have the same genetics. Not all CEOs are going to have the same mental capacity. And very similar to that, not all pipes are going to behave the same way. Not all road pavements are going to deteriorate in the same fashion. It all depends on the environmental parameters, the behavior patterns these assets exhibit. And when you combine that with the ability to realign those genetics, to realign those patterns of behavior and reconnect those dots, it throws open a whole range of options that we have never thought in the past. And that's called unlocking the hidden capital in infrastructure genetics. But let me just quickly set the scene. In 2030, it is expected that about $300 trillion worth of infrastructure around the world will be responsible for delivering services. But more importantly, 60% of the population will be living in major cities around the world. And that is a massive impact on what type of infrastructure we're going to need to be able to deliver those services 25, 30 years from now. Future infrastructure will have to be smarter because citizens are getting smarter and they will not accept failures. And this concept of infrastructure gap will simply not be acceptable. Infrastructure gap is a global issue. Doesn't matter which national infrastructure report card you look at, there is the constant use of the term backlog. And in really simple terms, if I can hone in on the term backlog, in really simple terms, infrastructure backlog is the difference between the rate at which it decays and our capacity to pay for the upgrade. It's simply the rate at which it decays and our capacity to upgrade. And the rate at which it decays is not just physical deterioration, it's also its capacity to perform. its alignment with what services are needed, its location, and its genetic behavior. It's a combination of all those things. Very simply put, if I can plot infrastructure life like a human life, and believe me, there is no difference between a pipe and a human being, or a road or a human being, or a sewage treatment plant and a human being, if I can use that term. Everyone has a life. And when that life reaches a point of infliction, the rate at which the performance of the infrastructure drops is significantly greater to the initial phase of that life. And that point of infliction creates this issue of infrastructure gap, because our capacity to pay constantly is lower than the rate at which that infrastructure is degrading. In contextual terms, if you're an asset-intense agency in charge of $100 billion, whether you are transport, a water treatment plant, an education facility, or a power plant, international statistics have $100 billion of infrastructure degrading at about $200 million per year. If the average capacity to upgrade and renew is about 120 million, the immediate gap for those sorts of figures is around 80 million a year. And here is the reality of life. Infrastructure gap is not static. And I'm going to hone in on some concepts here about looking at the reds in all the pictures. The red represents an asset that is performing at a lower capacity. Red represents an asset that is not delivering what we require in terms of its future capacity. And that infrastructure gap could grow from 80 to 240 million in real terms, because those yellows are constantly turning to red and the reds are constantly turning to cherry red. That gap is not static. The last 10 years have been spent on predicting these infrastructure gaps all around the world. US has got a massive infrastructure deficit, Canada, Australia, South Africa. But very little work has been done about what can we do to actually plug that gap without raising taxes, without spending more money, or without investing necessarily in new capital. And there is a way. And that way is genetic optimization, understanding patterns of behavior that are able to tell us different ways of joining the dots to spend the same amount of money on assets competing with each other in order to deliver a significantly lower way to achieve a better outcome. That science of infrastructure optimization is what comes from understanding patterns of behavior. Here's a simple example, a real life example. City of Salisbury in South Australia, where patterns of behavior clearly indicate if a footpath has got a different rate of genetic progression of a defect, or what is called a genetic distress, influenced by trees or soil type, as opposed to some of the other footpaths. And what that does is allowed Salisbury City to now model that into the future by changing the way it makes decisions on what assets it puts on the ground and environmental conditions around what those assets are involved with. Completely opens up a whole platform of information to reduce future cost by doing something genetically different. So a number of organizations around the world that we work with now have genetic patterns that can not only predict, but also showcase how their infrastructure can perform in the future if they slightly change the way they do things. Four common patterns on the screen. Within our Assetic platform, we've got about 4,000 of these patterns across about 400 different asset classes that mimic asset performance under certain environmental, social, economic conditions. Picture this from a smart city perspective. Smart city is about people, it's about place, it's more importantly about joining the dots with the data, and then it's connecting those dots with data to services. Everything I've spoken so far is setting the platform, not just for a smart city, but for smart water, smart transportation, smart power, etc. Those dots are joined by predicting and informing the customer at a very rapid pace. That's the trick, at a very rapid pace to allow the customer to make different decisions well in advance of an event occurring. The pace at which this information is delivered is quite critical in terms of infrastructure genetics. There's no point knowing of a bushfire 10 minutes before it occurs. or of a cyclone a day before it occurs. It's the timing of that event and the pace of that data that transforms us into a smarter organization. So here is an example, a real-life example using CityWorks maintenance system, the Esri spatial layer, which has got an infinite data mine in relation to demographics, environmental soil types, infrastructure behavior, and asset analytics, where this particular organization in the US is able to predict what it can deliver for $80 million on its underground pipe infrastructure compared to what it could deliver by just shifting a few levers, spending $110 million, increasing the intervention level on some of the assets, reducing the service levels on some of the assets, identifying the critical versus non-critical, and looking at a range of options that enable it to determine what the future city looks like, and in fact, ending up with the cheapest option of $60 million in an optimized environment using asset genetics to return a significantly better asset portfolio, but actually spending less money. And that's the power of the analytical platform where multiple data sources, multiple data points, patterns of behavior can actually predict and enable organizations to make better decisions about the future city. I'd just like to finish off by saying one thing. What you see on the screen is about 500,000 assets competing with each other for a scarce dollar. Each asset has about 7 or 8 options in its lifetime, and over a 50-year analysis period to work out the best way to spend the money, you're looking at more permutations than the number of atoms in the universe. Software these days, using big data, allows us to do that in minutes. This same process used to take days years ago, can be done in minutes to have information at the fingertips to provide asset planners with the ability to model the future and have the benefit of hindsight to actually not just predict the infrastructure gap, but to also plug the infrastructure gap without raising taxes. And on that note, ladies and gentlemen, I'm conscious of time. Thank you very much. It's been a pleasure presenting this session. Thank you.